Here's the thing, gentlemen. The presidential candidates also laid down their plans for the education sector, and here's what they had to say.
Sa maayos na gobyerno, prioridad ang kalidad at access sa education. May paralan sa lahat ng geographically isolated, disadvantaged at conflict-affected areas. May pagkakataon para sa ating mga senior high school students na kumita ng monthly allowance mula sa government internship program. At mas maraming mga estudyante ang siguradong makakatuloy at makakapagtapos ng kolehiyo.
Education, 4.3 of the GDP will be allocated to the education budget to improve student-teacher ratio, focusing on STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics.
Kailangan po ng palakasin natin yung education, suportahan natin yung mga kabataan, at yung ALS, suportahan po natin, dahil dyan po ako nagkaroon ng chance na maipagpatuloy ang aking pag-aaral. At higit sa lahat po ay yung isang estudyante, isang gadget.
Angat buhay sa edukasyon. Kapag world-class ang training sa guro, world-class ang facility sa paaralan, world-class ang support and edukasyon, tiyak na world-class din ang estudyante Pilipino. Para maitaas natin ang kalidad ng edukasyon, itataas din natin ang budget para dito.
Right, so back with Professor Edmond Tayao and former Dean of the Ateneo School of Government, Tony Lavini here. So gentlemen, here's the thing. Again, we know what's been ailing the education system for so long already. It was only exacerbated by the pandemic. They laid out their plans. We all know what to do. But how are they going to do it? Do you think that was answered by the candidates today? Dean Tony, you go first and then Professor Tayao.
No, the education answers, Carmina, for me, the answers of the candidates to the education question is that example of that would not appeal. Any of that answer would not appeal to the students. I know that the students have heard that same old type of thing. I mean, so they will not see that as the solving the problems that they are facing that have been exacerbated. Sayang because they could have differentiated themselves really by being very radical about what we need to do in our educational system, the kind of reforms that we have to build on from.
Give us an example. Like what were you hoping to hear from the candidates? Give us an example.
For example, improving connectivity in such a way that blended approaches to teaching becomes the game, right? I mean, the game that can equalize things. A commitment to state universities in regions, in local areas, that's really what you want to do. A commitment to private schools, because private schools are very important in the mix here for the educational system. I have a particular interest in schools for indigenous peoples, the schools for rural peoples, that they we need to be able to reach them, because if you don't reach them and build those schools, instead of closing them down, red tagging them, you build them up so that you can actually also address social inequality and give people more opportunities.
Right.
But you have to be really radical about it and not just continue with same old reforms.
Professor Edmond, did you find that any of the candidates actually bared how they were going to address the problem in the education sector? Go ahead.
Well, the closest that we have to a concrete answer is that of Mayor Isko. No? He mentioned the two important factors to my mind. The share of the sector, the education sector, as far as the budget is concerned. And of course, as far as the focus of education, which should be science and science, technology, and mathematics. But again, I can only echo what Dean Tony mentioned. There are clear challenges, no, that we're facing, not only because of the pandemic, but including the challenges that have been presented to us by the pandemic. And again, going back to Senator Ping, again, he mentioned about governance. And again, I couldn't agree more. The governance is is the primary factor, but he could have bridged it, no, to include, no, clear limitations to the current educational setup that we have, no. If I may also be specific, perhaps a review of our educational agencies, no, TESDA, CHED, and DepEd, no. Yeah. We copied that from Malaysia, if I'm not mistaken, some years back. But Malaysia already went back to a consolidated ministry for education. Dito sa atin, we're very fragmented. We were already fragmented, and we still keep on fragmenting the different agencies. So, in other words, there's so much more to be had. No, perhaps again because of time limitations that we don't hear much from the candidates.
All right, another hot topic in the presidential forum earlier today: the West Philippine Sea issue and the country's relations with China. Here are the candidates' responses.
Kailangan natin ang independent foreign policy. Makipagkasundo lamang tayo sa mga taong kumikilala o sa mga bansa na kumikilala sa ating soberenya.
Ang at buhay sa seguridad. Isusulong natin ang ating karapatan sa West Philippine Sea.
Pledge to each and every fisherman in this country. We will fish in West Philippine Sea.
There's no jet ski statement this time around. What are your thoughts about what the candidates said? Professor Tayo, you go first.
Well, I was hoping that they can tie it up with the bigger international political issue, because at the end of the day, it's now becoming clear that the West Philippine issue is not an isolated case. No one has mentioned the still brewing this realignment that's going to be brought by the Ukraine issue, no? Which is, of course, very much being watched, no, with concern by countries like Taiwan. No? So having said that, the broader picture here should in fact be the basis of our foreign policy, even if we say that we will be independent and we have to be independent as far as our foreign policy is concerned. It seems that it's not forward-looking, no? And so, therefore, might not allow us to be really independent as we would like to claim it. Masyadong kwan eh, no? The approach has always been, sad to say, parochial. It always only try to appeal to the senses of the general public. But the West Philippine Sea is not just an issue of fishing and not just an issue of bullying and so on. It's a bigger policy issue that can be addressed by a broader approach to foreign policy.
But wouldn't you also say, Dean Tony, that if you use these issues sort of as a pathway to make them understand the broader context of things, then that's how to best communicate this issue with the general public, Dean Tony?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I think the reason why it's not resonating to the general public is because precisely it is so limited, limited to a Philippines versus China thing, and only on the West Philippine Sea instead of the broader relationship and our broader foreign relations, right? Mm-hmm. And so the discourse is in a way so distorted, and the solutions that are given are very specific to this kind of problem, which can actually be dealt with, in less dramatic ways than both the Duterte government and the Aquino government have done. I mean, and so for me, the challenge for the next president is to find that way forward, the same that Ed just described.
Right. So as a final point here, the presidential candidates also shared their thoughts on how they will deal with a perennial problem of corruption. Take a look.
Isang maasahan at mapagkakatiwalaan na pamahalaan. This is my vow to the people. Sa loob ng unang 100 araw, sisimulan ko ang internal cleansing laban sa mga ICUs o mga inept, corrupt, at undisciplined government officials and employees. Our arsenal is a science-based, data-driven, and future-proof platform that can withstand the test of time.
Kasi pag may korupsyon na nangyayari, hindi naman yung kalaban namin yung mga makikinabang doon, kundi buong taong bayan. So para sa akin, kailangan magkaroon ng sistema at mekanismo para na-audit yung aming mga ginagawa. May eleksyon man o wala. Lalong-lalo na pag may eleksyon.
Smart governance. We must make public data open, freely available and downloadable in user-friendly and digestible format. We will simplify government processes and do this through digital and automation, and review and amend existing outmoded laws and regulation. Lesser human discretion, lesser corruption, naturally corruption will die.
The only way na magkaroon tayo ng magandang kinabukasan is sugpuin yung corruption na yan. Kawawa ang ating mga kababayan. Walang magandang kinabukasan na hinaharap kung nandyan palagi ang corruption. Kaya nga, in my time, pagdating ng panahon, God willing, lahat ng mga kawatan sa gobyerno magsama-sama sa kulungan.
Here's the thing, gentlemen. Wala namang kandidato ang hindi mangangako na hindi susugpuin ng korupsyon. Hindi ba? So we expected all of them to say this. But my question to you is, who among the candidates presented a concrete plan of action? And not just a concrete plan of action, but actually something that is doable if and when they become president? Dean Tony.
I think Senator Lacson, is the one, he also the one that knows this issue the most. And actually, I also specialize on this and on the legal aspects of this. We have everything in the books already. We have all the laws that are necessary. We actually have all the institutions necessary to make this work. And so I think that approach of just really doubling down on everything that we already have and doing it properly is what we need to do. So I think the answer of Senator Lacson was the wisest and the most practical, to be honest.
Professor Edmund.
Well, I also agree. I think the closest, no? And when I mean the closest, medyo kulang pa din. But the closest answer to concretely address the problem of corruption is that of Senator Ping. Close second is that of Mayor Isko, because Mayor Isko mentioned the need for transparency and way to inform the public, no, as far as the operation of the government is concerned, including expenditures and so on and so forth. However, wala sa kanilang nagsabi na systemic itong problema, paulit-ulit na pinag-uusapan ito. At the end of the day, and again, as Dean Tony has already mentioned, we already have so many laws, but our problem really is public institutions. We have very weak public institutions precisely because the kind of politics that we have is not a system that we can actually call institutional and focus on processes and so on. Sa atin, it's always spoils driven. No? Whoever is in position is the one that dictates what is right, what can be done, what cannot be done, and so on and so forth. And so we always hear this as a sad refrain. Every election, we talk about corruption, but not one talks about how concretely we can change it by way of system.
And maybe that's what we should look for as we listen these candidates.
For decades.
All right. So finally, before we let you go, I want to ask you, who was a better communicator in this round? I mean, as I told Dean Tony a while ago, we're still in the early days of this season. Lots of changes expected still. But for this presidential forum, who was a better communicator? Who presented himself or herself as the leader that would take us out of this COVID crisis? Take us back onto the path of economic recovery. Your thoughts on these, gentlemen. Let's go with Professor Ed, and then we end with Dean Tony. Go ahead.
Well, based on the answers and based on the way he explained, no, alam mo kasi minsan when you speak of communication, it's not only the content, it's also the way it's delivered, no. Mm-hmm. So with all this criteria, I can handily give it to Senator Ping Lacson, and obviously he prepared and knows what he's talking about.
Dean Tony.
I would have to agree. with that, and I've always anticipated that when it comes to interviews and debates, Senator Lacson will always come out on top because she's solid. He knows his stuff. He's been there for a long time. His experience, right? I would just say though that VP Lenny also did very well. Very high energy, very passionate, grounded as well. You know, I was surprised about Mayor Isko. Everything he said was good. The content was good, but you know, it's very formal. And I kind of expect Mayor Isko to be more foxy, right? More can deal with the audience. But it seemed like he was like in a job, truly in a job, which is actually a good thing too. He was respecting the journalist. He was like, you know, I'm not gonna play around with you, and like he does with his audiences, where he kids the audiences, etc. So that was a thing. I mean, but certainly Senator Pacquiao was also sincere, and Caliode gave us an alternative vision of what the Philippines could be.
All right, gentlemen, thank you for joining us today. Appreciate all your thoughts and your insights. Professor Edmund Tayo, Executive Director of the Local Government Development Foundation, and of course, a former Dean of the Ateneo School of Government, Tony Lavinia. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining us today.
Maraming salamat po.
Maraming salamat.
Appreciate it. Take care and you keep safe, guys.